Hey, what's up guys, Swiss Maverick here. I'm your man when it comes to ArmA 2 and ACE tutorials. Today we're gonna have a look at ACE artillery, which is a very complex system. I never really felt like going into it because when I use artillery in ArmA 2, I usually use the scripted one or the artillery modules that come with the vanilla game. But I just recently watched a video about ACE artillery and I figured, oh come on, I'm gonna give it a try, and it's actually quite interesting, so I decided to make a tutorial. This one is rather extended. If you watch it in your web browser with annotations turned on, you get the chapter selection at the beginning. This should make it easier for you to navigate through the video. I'm not gonna cover all the artillery weapons in the game. I'm just gonna show you guys real quick the M270 with the artillery computer, which is like the simplest one, and then we're mostly gonna focus on the M119 with the battery computer, and the other stuff that is in the game are the mortars, but they work with range tables and I'm not really into that, not yet. Maybe I'm gonna give that a try and do another video as well. But today we're going to mostly focus on the M119 Howitzer. I will have to cover a lot of content for you to understand how it works. I'm going to try to like focus on the main things, go straight through it. But on the other hand, I want to give you guys some vital information. So if you're already used to it, I guess you don't even have to watch the video. But sometimes, yeah, I try to give more information than may be necessary for you to learn something, and some people really appreciate that. They are happy about that. Other people interpret that as just rambling on and they get pissed off. So I guess I cannot make everyone happy. But if you don't need the information, just don't watch the video. Or use the chapter selection to focus on the part where you have a problem with the ACE artillery. For those of you who didn't know it yet, I actually served 6 years in the Swiss Armed Forces, and I was in the artillery. In Switzerland we used the M109 self-propelled howitzer, and it's a lot more complex than here in the game. We use a communication system that works like almost like an internet, you know, like an integrated system with computers and stuff, and we use it to just command the whole brigade actually, and we can also command the fire from the artillery as a indirect firing support weapon. I was a signals specialist, so I was responsible for bringing up the system and maintaining it, so the brigade commander was able to use his artillery and gather information about hostile movements and all that. When I first started in the military, I was a LAV driver, and during my journey, during those 6 years, I became a first lieutenant, and pretty much at the end I was responsible for the whole system within the brigade HQ. Alright gents, let's get to the good stuff. We're gonna start with the mission setup, chapter 1.2, then go into roles within a like an artillery firing team, and then we're gonna do some shooting. In this part I'm gonna show you guys the mission setup. Pretty much used all the content that is necessary, and you're gonna have to place quite a few objects on the map for it to work or for you to use the artillery. So first things first, obviously you're gonna need a player, some kind of a character that is selected as player, and then you have to integrate the weapons. So double click units F1, double click on the map, and then you can find them under empty, and class is artillery, RT howitzers, and right here you get the selection of available artillery. So we get the 120mm mortar, we get the 82mm, we get the M119 howitzer, the M224 60mm mortar, the M252 81mm mortar. So those are the howitzers, or like the artillery weapons. And right here you get the MLRS, empty armored desert or woodland, and somewhere we get M270 MLRS, so that is easy to find. Right here you see the mortars, so that's for the weapons. Then we go into ammunition, ammo boxes, empty ammunition, RT, so artillery, and here you get a lot of ammo boxes, and you gotta pick the one you need for your weapon. So we have the M119, which is a 105mm howitzer, so it's like the first five boxes, and then we get the different ammunition types. A.C.E. is high explosive, elimination, and then we get two types of smoke. I'm not even sure what the difference is, to be honest. And DPICM is like a cluster shell. Then same thing for the 120mm mortars, different weapon or different ammunition, 60mm, 81mm, 82mm. So you gotta make sure to pick the right ammo for your weapon. I advise you to place it somewhere near the weapon itself. Okay, so this goes for the mortars and for the howitzer. MLRS does not have any ammo boxes or something. You can reload them with an ammo truck, but they come or they spawn with 12 rockets, 12 missiles actually, right at the beginning. So that's for weapon and ammunition. And now, to use the M119 howitzer, you're gonna need a battery computer. To be honest, I think it's also possible to do it with a range table, but I don't know how to do it. This would be like the manual system, but I guess the electronic system is more realistic. As I said, in Swiss Armed Force we use a very complex system, even complexer than this one right here. But I advise you to use that, even though it might be possible with a range table. Empty artillery equipment, and then you get here battery computer. You get also the aiming cycle and aiming posts and all that, but you will not need it. They will already be spawned with your weapon. Okay, so you don't need to place them separately on the map. Battery computer is a Humvee, US Army for the desert version, and USMC for the woodland version. Simple, place on the map and you're good to go. Alright, so we get like the main character that I'm playing. I got all the weapons, all the ammunition, and the battery computer. That's pretty much what you need in your firing base. It is possible to do the whole thing just by yourself, as I'm gonna show you in the video, but I definitely advise you to do it in multiplayer with a few people. I'm gonna explain the roles in the next part. Something else you need is obviously target area. Just made something here for to train on it. And what you want to do is you want to create yourself an observer. If you do it in single player, make sure that he's playable, so you can use team switch to switch to him and see the impacts and adjust the fire if necessary. Okay, we're actually having two target locations here, one rather close, one a bit further. So that's what you need: your main base with the weapons and somewhere a target area and a spotter for the artillery controller. So I guess that's already the mission setup. Let's have a look at the designated roles of a artillery firing team. What I'm telling you here is just my personal opinion, my personal interpretation of the situation. I don't know really what the standard is, because as I said, I'm not used to this kind of artillery. We use different ones in Switzerland. I guess the MLRS is pretty self-explanatory. You get a driver and a gunner, and yeah, maybe an observer, but that's about it. Mortars, especially the smaller ones, are usually operated in two-man teams, and yeah, also plus an observer. This bigger mortar is probably a team with more people, maybe three or four, I can't really tell you. And for the M119 howitzer, the main gun we're gonna be focusing on today, I advise a team of at least three plus an observer. So the roles that you're gonna have is like the squad leader. In my opinion, this would be the guy that operates the battery computer here from the Humvee. So he does the main calculations and coordinates especially the other characters here around the gun, you know, with loading with adjusting the weapon, preparing the ammunition, loading, and then he's gonna be the one that gives the order to fire once he's ready. Usually an artillery gun is never operated just as a single gun. Usually you get an artillery battery consisting of multiple guns. We are in Switzerland, for example, an artillery battery consists of 6 M109 Howitzers. They always operate together. So it's never just one gun that works autonomous, you know, except for maybe a smaller mortar. So squad leader is the battery computer operator, coordinates the stuff here. Then you're gonna get the gunner, obviously. He's the one that does the adjustments on the weapon, you know, elevation and all that. And then you get the loader, which is responsible for prepping the ammunition. You're gonna see how that works later. It's very interesting with the ACE artillery. And he's gonna load the gun and just helps the gunner operating the weapon. So that makes three on this location right here. And another one further away, the observer that has eyes on target, obviously. You could extend this group, as I just mentioned before, so you could have one squad leader and then two howitzer crews or three howitzer crews plus an observer. So this would look pretty cool, I guess. You know, three howitzers shooting at the same time, Yeah, that's something for multiplayer. So I guess that's how I would split up the roles. Squad leader, gunner, loader, and observer. Okay, in this chapter we're gonna look at the battery computer, which would be operated by the squad leader. As you see here, I've got some more gear. Just gonna show you what I have. I picked up an ANPRC 117F Echo radio. This would be the long range radio that I use as a squad leader to communicate with the spotter. I also have an ANPRC 343, which I could use to communicate just with the artillery crew or with the gun crew. They're just outside the Humvee, but for me to communicate with them easier, I could use that radio, and especially if I have like three or four guns around me as a squad leader, I will need some radio communication, not just direct chat from inside the Humvee. So we got two radios, and I got a dagger, which is like a GPS device that comes with ACE. This is good to find your positions and stuff. And I also got the regular ArmA GPS. I'm gonna show you the difference in a minute. So I'm pretty much ready now as a squad leader. I can communicate with my crews, with the observer. The battery computer is ready in that Humvee. What I need to do before I can start the fight or start bringing artillery fire to the AO is I need to have a grid reference where the gun is standing or where my battery is standing. So this is pretty easy actually. You go as close as possible to the gun, something like that. Make sure you don't get hurt. It happened to me that I broke my leg, so I was stuck into the gun right here. And then you can either use the ArmA 2 instead of the vanilla GPS that is displayed in here. So I can get this grid information, 8-digit grid, where my gun is standing or where I'm standing right now. I get the altitude, which is important, and I get the direction where I'm facing right now. That's one way to do it. Another way to do it is with the dagger. If I press the default, I think it's the home key on your keyboard, the dagger will show up here on the lower right. Should give me the same information. You get the 8-digit grid and you get the elevation, 2083 meters. And if I look around, you get on the lower left side, the track is the angle or the direction where I'm looking at. Okay, so I'm just gonna write that down now. 0541124 is the grid. I'm gonna need that. I'm gonna need the elevation. I'm just gonna do the ground level elevation. Well, it's the same. 2083 meters. And the last piece of information I need is like the direction where the gun is looking, or the gun is facing right now. So what I'm gonna do, there's multiple ways to find that out. I can either just like try to stand exactly behind the gun and then bring out my compass and align the compass with the barrel. So this is important, that this is as accurate as possible, because otherwise the firing missions will not be accurate if this is set off. Okay. Ah, shit. Damn it. Yeah, this is pretty good, I guess. As you can see, the barrel is pretty much straight south. Okay. If I turn a bit to see the number, it's 180 degrees on the inner circle, and on the outer circle it says 32. And 32 is actually 3,200 mils. So the inner circle is 360 degrees, the outer circle is 6,400 mils. So it's a lot tighter scale, you know, and it's a lot more accurate on long distance firing. That's why artillery always works with mils. So one complete circle is 6,400 mils, and my gun is pointing pretty much straight south. That is correct, because I know how I placed it on the map in the editor. And this would be 3,200 mils. Okay, so I gotta write that down as well. This is one way to get that deflection. Another way, if I got a vector, so a rangefinder, I can use that. Can stand a bit further away, pretty much align myself with the gun, then I have to put in a battery, and as you can see now I get an angle, 180 degrees. To get the mils, I click left alt and R, and then the dagger will switch, or will switch to mils, you know. Left alt R mils. There you go. Okay, so now I'm gonna point. I'm gonna try to align with the gun. There you go. Not quite sure what the problem was. It was kind of messed up. But now I got 3,200 mils. So this is pretty accurate. So here again, mission creator, mission maker, make sure to place the gun in a good direction in the editor. This way it's gonna be easier for the gun crew to operate it. Alright, as a squad leader, as battery computer operator, I'm gonna need the grid of the gun or the battery. If I have multiple guns, it would like take the center position. I'm gonna need the altitude, and I'm gonna need the deflection where the gun is pointing at right now. Okay. So I need those three informations. I'm ready to operate the battery computer. I get in the Humvee, doesn't matter what position I have, driver or backseat. And then in the scroll wheel I get the option to use ANGYK37BCS. I click on that and then this baby appears. So this is the battery computer system, and here I can now integrate or insert information, and this computer will actually generate me fire solutions, or calculate fire solutions for me, and then I can give that information to the gun crew and they can align the gun and fire. Okay, so this is a pretty sophisticated machine. It's pretty cool. You get here like the main panel where you enter information. You can open the map from here with the mouse click, and you can control your echo radios. But this is very excellent. Right now you see I got the ANPRC 343, so this will be like the radio to communicate with the gun crew outside. And since I'm packing another radio, the 117, I can cycle through the radios. So just by a click right here I could switch from command communicating with the ground crew to communicating with the spotter, for example, the other artillery observer. And also, if I have one selected, I can open it and I can adjust channels and stuff as you know it from your ECO radios. To exit anything, always use escape. To get back, also here, escape and you're back. You can move, exit the vehicle or whatever. So that's just for like how the display here works and the stuff you get. Now we're gonna start entering information and calculator fire solution. Battery name doesn't really matter, I'm just gonna call it Artie. Then call sign, this would be the call sign of the artillery battery. So for example, any kind of squad leader could call in artillery, or maybe the artillery observer could call in artillery and they would call us with that call sign. I'm just gonna call us Ripper. And then the battery type, that is important, what kind of weapon you use. It's the M119A1 105mm howitzer, that's the weapon we have. You also get the option to calculate solutions for the 60mm mortars apparently, but not for the 81 and the 120mm. Don't ask me why, I'm not an ACE developer. Now important here is the grid, where our battery is placed. That's the information I just gathered before. So this would be grid 0544-1124. 8 figure grids always. Then altitude was 2083 meters above sea level. And then the direction of fire, that's what we had trying to find out while looking over the barrel there, which was 3200 mils direct south. Target prefix and target start, or target number start, is not that important. I'm just gonna go with 1-1. And here on the other side, you could integrate and or insert and save different observers. So if you're firing at multiple AOs and you have multiple forward observers, you can save them. You can save known points, like a main AO or something. Not really sure what it does though, what it helps, but it's possible to like save those known points. I'm just gonna do an example now. I guess most of you already know how a grid system on a map works. We're just gonna try to find out the grid of this first target area. Now, as you can see on the top, you get numbers 085, 086, 087. So from left to right, it's increasing. Right here on the left side, you get numbers as well. 099, 100, 102. So from bottom to top, it's increasing. Now to get the rough grid, which is just 6 figures, you start with the numbers on top. You see the target areas right here, so it will be in grid 087 and 099. So those are 6 figure grids. They're okay for calling in choppers and stuff, but they're not accurate enough to call in artillery. So we want to add an extra number to that grid and make it an 8 figure grid. And this is how it works. You get here, if you zoom in to the max on the map, you get a scale here. Well, you got always a scale that is changing, and the tightest zoom factor, it's going to be 20 meters for that distance, which means one of those squares is 100 on 100 meters. Okay, so from left to right, 20, 40, 60, 80, 100, same thing from bottom to top. Now to get that grid reference here exactly, you go to 087, and this will be probably about a tenth, so 10 meters, 0871. And you do the same thing here from bottom to top, 099, 20, 40, 60, 80, about 90, 100, okay? So 0999. Our complete 8 figure grade would be 0871 0999. All right, it's as easy as that. Now there's a new point, new known point name, oil rig grid 0871 0999. Altitude, missed that. Altitude would be Because this is high ground, from where it is, on flat level, to 188. It's kind of hard to say. I guess it would be somewhere to 195 or so. Now you can add or update, add a known point, auto rig, add grid, blah blah blah. And you see that here now. Can enter a new one or can select my new my preset grid. So yeah, I'm not really sure what to use it for actually, but this is how it works. Alright, so I got this information right here. Now I want to calculate the fire solution. I click on grid on the left side. And then mission grid reference. So this is my target area. I'm going to use the same thing I just figured out before. 0971 08 0871 0999. This way. And this was THU 195. Then I can enter target description, depending on what the observer tells me. Radius and width, which is like the target size. I'm just gonna go with 50. The length of the target is about the same in this example, and the attitude is like the direction where the target is facing. But that's not really important for this target, because it's like, yeah, it's just an area where I want to shoot at. Just gonna type in 1600 mils, which will be east. Alright, so much for that. Then now on the right side, method of engagement, danger close, which this means if you got hot friendlies in an area or rather close, it will be danger close firing. You can select no or yes. I'm not sure what the difference is actually, if the game somehow gives out an automatic warning, you know, for the friendlies in that area. I really don't know. I couldn't try it just by myself. So I'm gonna go no. I can enter notes. Don't really need that either. And here now it's getting interesting. So this is ammunition, HE, high explosive, DPICM is like a cluster shell. Almost like a cluster bomb. It will deploy a few meters or a few 10 meters over the ground. It will release a bomblet, a rain, and it's kind of with like a rain of frag grenades, you know. I can fire smoke, I can fire illumination. We're gonna take the easiest one, which is high explosive. Then the fuse is important as well. Point detonate means it will detonate right as it hits the ground. Proximity is important for a mid-air explosion shortly over the ground. Then you can use a time delay, which is important for illumination. For example, you don't want illumination grenades to go off when they hit the ground. You want them to go off while they're in the air, so they can illuminate the battlefield, obviously. So there you would have to use time fuse, and you can use a delay fuse. That's in real life used if you shoot at bunker or buildings. So you want the grenade to go through the roof inside the building and then deploy. So you would set a delay for maybe 0.5 seconds or something, or even shorter. So the grenade goes off once inside the building. But we don't need that here. We're just gonna go with point detonate, easiest one. Fuse time is not needed with this kind of fuse. Round count is important. I'm just gonna go with one round. Adjust round count one, adjust piece one. That's if you have multiple pieces, multiple guns, you can set what kind or which gun is gonna do the adjust firing. Not really necessary now. Sheaf, I'm not sure what that means. Parallel, you can't switch anything, so doesn't really matter. Method of control, this is important for me here as a battery computer operator, or as the squad leader. Fire when ready, this is like the fire order. So one way to do it is if I give the go to the gun crew, they prep the weapon, and as soon as they're ready, they're gonna fire at my command. If I have multiple guns, I want every gun to get ready, report back to me, and once all my guns are ready, I'm gonna give the order to fire. I can give a time from now, which means on the fire order, 5 minutes, then the bullets or the shells go off. Or time from clock, I can say at 16:05 or so, the firing is gonna start. So this is those are the options I'm having. Fire when ready, it does the job. If I use timed firing orders, I can enter them right here. So this is pretty much all the information I'm gonna need. If I'm gonna click on adjust, the computer will calculate firing solutions for me based on the information I gave him here. You can see down here a lot of stuff is going on. I can scroll that information here. The lowest information is 8, or the last information is 8 valid firing solutions found for 105mm M1HE. So now the computer generated me 8 different firing solutions. The first one is always like the one with the lowest flight pattern, and the highest number, which will be 8 here, is always the one with the highest flight pattern. Artillery is an indirect firing weapon, so usually almost like a mortar, you shoot in a pretty steep angle, and the shells will come pretty much straight down onto target. You can also use lower angle firing, but it's gonna be less accurate. And the advantage though is that the bullets are gonna be on target a lot faster. So let's have a look at the stuff. Fire mission platoon adjust number one round, and then this is like the information we're gonna need afterwards once we decide what kind of firing solution we're gonna take. The azimuth is like the deflection, so the horizontal angle. The charge is what kind of charge we're gonna need for the shell to actually travel the distance. Deflection is gonna be the same as azimuth, so deflection is like the sideways angle, the horizontal angle. Quadrant 120 is like the elevation, so the vertical angle. One round is how many rounds the series is gonna consist of, and the fuse is quick in effect. So that's what we're gonna need. Message to observer, I pretty much can just say that here. Ripper, HE in effect, one round, blah blah blah. So it even tells me what I have to radio to the observer. TOF is time of flight, 8.1 seconds. So this is how long the bullet's gonna take, or the grain is gonna take to reach target. What I can do here is shoot, and the count, like the bullet counter, or the time of flight counter will start. So I could actually, if I hit on the right time when the gun is actually shooting outside, I could give the spotter information of about splash, you know. So that's just fun stuff. All right, so this is like the lowest firing solution. Especially look at this right here, quadrant 120, which is the elevation, so the vertical angle, and the time of flight. If I go to the next solution, this number will increase. So the elevation is going to be steeper, and the time of flight will increase. And if I go through this to the solution 8 of 8, I get a quadrant of 1142 and a time of flight of 40 seconds. I do advise you, if you get time, you know, if the ground team doesn't need like super immediate fire, to always pick the highest firing solution, because it's the most accurate. I tried it a few times, and the lower solutions pretty much always went over target, like by maybe 100 meters or so, and the higher solutions are pretty much straight on target. So for more accurate fire, I advise you to do that. Alright, so we're gonna need to write down some more vital information. First thing we're gonna need is deflection. The set deflection is like the azimuth, the sideway, the horizontal angle, which is 1972. We're gonna need quadrant, which is the elevation, so the vertical angle is 1142 with that solution. And we're gonna need the charge size, or yeah, the charge type, which is charge 3. Now this information, as a squad leader, I have to relay to my gun crew outside. So I would switch to the radio 343, and I would give them the information. So the gunner could start preparing the gun, adjusting the gun, getting it ready to fire, and the loader could start either helping the gunner or it could start to preparing the rounds. So one round with a charge 3, and this primer, this fuse, that will be the loader's job. Okay, so right now we get the information. I could use fire, but now it gives me an error message because I haven't integrated an observer. It doesn't really matter because I cannot order the gun to fire from here. All right, so I think this does it for the battery computer. This is the vital information. I know it's a lot of blah blah, but that's what you need. I'm pretty sure there's stuff I haven't figured out yet because here's like polar. I'm not sure what that does. It changes something. I can integrate an observer here. I haven't tried out what it does actually. And I get shift. I can integrate some other stuff here as well. With shift here, I could use the selected or pre-entered locations, you know, like oil rig and stuff. So this could be fun. Give it a try yourself if you're interested in finding out all the options of this battery computer. So this will pretty much be the job for me as a squad leader. I have to calculate those solutions. I have to pick the solution that is most suited, also based on the terrain. You know, if you got a huge mountain between you and the target, you cannot choose a low firing solution. You got to take a high one for the bullet to travel over the mountain and not hit it. So that's the decision of the squad leader, and then he has to relay the information about deflection, about the quadrant, and the charge to the gun crew. In this next part of this tutorial, I'm going to show you guys the mission of the gunner. So how to adjust the weapon based on the information that we gathered with the battery computer before. First things first, I'm going to show you guys the items we're going to need. The most important thing is this here, which is like, I'm not sure what it's called. I think it's called like the aiming unit or something. And we're gonna see that in the spotting scope of the gun afterwards. In front of me there you see those two aiming poles. I'm not really sure what they do, because obviously or apparently you don't need them, at least not for this procedure. Another thing that is important is this right here. This is like the aiming thingy. It's almost like a periscope. So as a gunner, try to get an angle for you to see it good. As a gunner, you would look in there, and then you get like this periscope that leads to this unit, and with a mirror, you can see out there. You know, if I go into as gunner and tap 0 on the numpad, I'm gonna look through that periscope, and as you can see, it's aiming straight to that aiming unit that is standing on the ground. Okay. Now, if I do my adjustments afterwards, it will be offset, because by doing the adjustments, I will just like turn the top of this of this periscope. I will turn that, and afterwards I have to turn the gun to align it again with this aiming unit. Okay. So as a gunner, I go in as gunner. I can tap 0 if I want. And then I should get the option in the scroll wheel, view M137, M187. I click on that, and then this adjustment window appears. And now here I get some information: azimuth, deflection, side mount, elevation, the level, and here I get some buttons I can press. Now what I have to do is I have to adjust or I have to enter the information I gathered before. So we're gonna start with the deflection. I get def minus def plus, and deflection is the horizontal angle. So the information we got with the mills, and we figured that out with the battery computer. It was 1972. Right now I'm on 322, so I have to click like 1200 times. If I click on minus, you see the numbers decreasing. By a single click on that, it will decrease by the amount of 1. As you can see, the scope is like turning now, and I'm slightly gonna lose the unit, the sighting unit, out of my view. So I don't want to click 1200 times on that button. So by holding shift and tab, it will change the number by a factor of 10, and by holding control shift and click on the left mouse key here, it will change the deflection by amount of 100. So I'll get a adjust to 1972. So closing in. I'm gonna go with steps of 10 now. 1978. And now with single steps, 1972. Now here deflection 1972, that is the amount I calculated with the battery computer. As you can see now, the aiming is like totally offset. Doesn't matter, we're gonna adjust that afterwards. So this is the deflection, like the sideways angle. This is adjusted now. Then next thing we're gonna do is adjust the elevation, which is called quadrant in the information from the battery computer. That was 1142. Works the same way here with elevation. You see here this like zero is pretty much zeroed in now between those two lines. If I start changing something, you see the elevation number changing, and this zero here is kind of getting out of sight. So I gotta go up to 1142. I can use shift, control shift again to increase with steps of 100. Okay, now elevation is set to 1142. That is correct. But now you see here the zero is totally offset. It's not no longer between those lines. And to do that, I have to use the up and down arrows. Important here, don't click the left and right arrows by accident, because that's gonna mess up your aim. Just the up and down arrows. Now if I click the up arrow, you see the elevation, the gun is turning downwards. So I click the down arrow and it's gonna increase the elevation. I'm slightly aiming upwards. I'm using a high firing solution, so the gun is gonna be pointing pretty much in a steep angle upwards. I just keep pressing the downwards arrow, and at some point the zero is gonna start moving. There you go. Okay, see it moving now. And what I have to do as a gunner, I have to adjust it until the zero is back between those two lines. That's what we have right now. So the elevation is set and the deflection is set, but just on the aiming unit. What I have to do now, if I'm alone, I have to get out of the gun and adjust it myself. If I have a loader, he would help me here. Okay, so if I go to change view, see now totally offset, I'm no longer aiming at the sighting unit. So I go out, and if you look at this thing right here, you see it has changed. It's no longer facing the aiming unit, it's facing somewhere else. So with the deflection, I only changed this periscope right here. And what I have to do now, I have to turn the gun again, or I have to turn the gun until I see the aiming unit again through the scope. And I can do that by grabbing the gun. I have to shift it to the left, obviously. So I go shift M119 left, the character kind of grabs the thing, and now with the W and not just with the S key, I can pull the gun. Try to look around. As you can see, the gun is turning now. And I have to turn it so long until the aiming sights, the periscope, is facing the aiming unit again. So I'm gonna quick check, press C to like stand to release the gun. Oh, there you go. And you see now it's still very much offset. It's pointing somewhere over there. So I gotta pull some more. Now if you're all alone, oh shit, that was the wrong key. If you're all alone, it's really annoying to sight the gun. If you have a loader as gunner, you just look through the scope, the loader pulls until you say stop. Yeah, this is probably the best I can get. So now the gun is sighted. Just gonna recheck here. Deflection 1972, that's okay. Elevation 1142, that's okay. And the level here is the zeros between those two lines. So now the gun is sighted and I'm ready to fire. In this next part of the video, we're gonna look at the loader's role. He's obviously responsible for preparing the ammunition, bringing it to the weapon, load it, and the second job he has is to assist the gunner with adjusting the weapon to bring it on target, as we've seen it before. Now, preparing the ammunition is actually pretty cool here with this ACE artillery. What you see right here are those ACE ammo boxes for the M119. I walk up to the box and I don't press G or gear in the mouse wheel, I press the interaction key, the ACE interaction key. Prepare RT rounds. Right now I'm at the high explosive round box. You see here, the round count is just 3 right now because I already fired 2 rounds before. So usually it's 5, high explosive. Then you get the charge type. It's default is set to 8, and I gotta reduce this to the amount my battery computer calculated, and you can select the fuse. So the calculations resulted in a charge 3 for the highest firing resolution. You can even see the picture here on the side changing. This is pretty cool. So you see the lower the charge, the fewer explosives there are in there, obviously. This is awesome. This is excellent. Very nice. Charge 3. Then fuse type, point detonate. That's what we have for the HE rounds selected. You can proximity time or delay. Time we're going to look at later. We're going to use point detonate, so explosion on impact. Charge 3, point detonate. Then I click on prep round. You see very fast here, top left side, a bar increasing. We're just going to do another one. Charge 3, prep round. I tap escape. And right here are my rounds. Pretty nice. I walk up to them. ACE interaction key again. On the right side you get this window. 105 M1 rounds. PD is point detonate, fuse, charge 3. So here you get information about the round to identify them if you create multiple different rounds. I can prepare shell, so I can adjust something on it, change the fuse or whatever. I can repack it in the box or I can carry it. Just for changing fuse type, if I go to the other box, DCIPM rounds, a TPICM, they usually are fused with the time. Here it is important that the squad leader on the battery computer gives you the time of flight of the bullet or of the projectile. For our firing solution, I think it's 41 seconds. So right here I would adjust the fuse type to maybe 3 seconds before impact, so the shell would like fall apart on that fuse time, and then those bomblets will be released and spread around a wider area. You know, that's for this cluster round what the DPICM is. So you can give it a try with like fuse time minus the time of flight minus 3 seconds equals the fuse time, but I guess you're gonna have to to try that a bit, and especially observer will have to give you information about the results on target, and then you can adjust that for the second round. So this is just the time or the difference between those fuses. Okay, we're ready to fire now. The gun is sighted, the rounds are prepared. I walk up to them, use the ACE interaction key while looking at them. Then I get information here on the top right, 105 shell, PD, point detonation fuse, charge 3. So this is important. If I have different rounds prepared here on one area, so this way I can identify them. I can repack the shell back in the box, I can prepare it, so open the menu and change the fuse or something, and I can carry it. If I'm carrying it, it's yeah, it's not really beautifully animated, but we're used to that from ArmA. It doesn't matter, the function is important. I walk up to the gun, ACE interaction key again, load gun. As you can hear the loading sound, and the gun is ready to fire. Now, to fire it, I will have to go in as gunner, obviously. It doesn't really matter where I'm looking because the gun is sighted, you know. I don't see the target, obviously. And now I just give the go to my squad leader, to the battery commander. If you have multiple howitzers, you know, they all prepare their weapons, their ammunition, all that. And every gun is going to report in ready. And if as soon as everyone's ready, the battery commander would order fire, and then all guns would fire at the same time, you know. So this is how it works in real life, usually. So we don't have anyone to give us orders now, we're just gonna fire away. Left mouse button as you're used to, and the round is gone. So this is how you load and fire your gun. One thing that is important as a gunner, if I open my menu here, usually after the shot, the elevation level will be offset. So the recoil of the weapon will change the elevation. What I have to do now is I have to use the up and down arrows on my keyboard to readjust the barrel, you know, the sighting of the barrel. Do not click elevation plus and elevation minus as shown in the video. I made a mistake here when I recorded. Fortunately, I saw it when I looked through it again. So use the up and down arrows to adjust the barrel and not adjust like the programming of the weapon. Okay, we're at the observer spot right now. Over there, the Ulrich is my target. So let's see where the grenade is gonna hit. TOF is somewhere around 40 seconds. That was quite a bit off target. What I can do as a spotter, I can just mark the impact. It was somewhere over here. Because that's what I'm gonna need to give a reference back to the squad leader, the battery commander, for the adjusting fire. To adjust the fire as an observer, I have to give some information back to the battery commander. The first thing is my direction of view towards the target, and then the set off of the impact, you know. So I can use my compass again to get the direction towards target. I'm pretty much gonna look towards the oil rig there. Come on. And I'm pretty much on 4200 mils, so 4200 mils. I can also use my vector again, R for battery load, and I'm already on mils. Otherwise it would be Alt R, then you get to mils. It's pretty much 4200, that's accurate enough. So that's important. I gotta report that back to the battery commander. Now the impact was over there. So what I gotta do now is I gotta kind of imagine a cross in front of me, as you can see here in that awesome graphics I created. The blue dot on the bottom is like the observer, so that's my position. The red dot at the top is the target position. The black dot at the right in this example is the impact. And now I gotta figure out how many meters I have to adjust, you know, from my direction of view. So the bullet, the impact was too far right, so it's about 150 meters further left until it's like in the crossing line of my direction to of view towards the target. So minus 150 would be an adjustment to the left. The bullet was too close to me in perspective to the target, so I have to add more, which would be around 250 meters. So the bullet from my direction of view again, the grenade has to impact about 250 meters further away. If the bullet were over the target, you know, too far away, I would have to to reduce the distance. So a minus number. If it were too far left, I had to add some meters to the right. So this is about how it works. I hope it's somewhat understandable. So what I have to report now to the battery commander is my direction of view to the target, which was 4200 mils, minus 150 correction left, plus 250 correction forward. Switching back to squad leader, get in here, battery computer. Now for the adjust fire, you get this right here. OT direction is obviously the direction where the observer is looking at, so 4200 mils. And then we had left, minus 150, this is meters. Right correction to the right will be just 150 or plus 150, and then add drop. So add would be further away, drop would be closer to me. We had plus 250. This should do the job, I hope. I go to adjust. It's gonna recalculate the information. I go to the high solution again, and now we get new information. We still got charge 4, we got a deflection of 2056, and we got a quadrant of 1142. So the adjustment should be further right for the gun, and the elevation is going up just a little bit. Fuse is still, a charge is still 3, so that's cool. I cut out the part where I'm getting the gun and ammunition ready, so we're just gonna fire away now and see if those adjustments are effective or not. Yeah, I don't think it's gonna get any better. Fire away. Switching back to the observer. So I hope this is on target now, or at least closer. It took me a long time to figure out how to do this plus minus stuff, you know. I had to shoot at least 30 rounds until I figured out which way does which correction, but it seems to be working that way. Boom! Right on the money. That was excellent. I didn't expect it to be that accurate now. So this was a pretty good example of, yeah, rather perfect adjustment. I hope it's kind of understandable with that graphic I created. You know, how to have to imagine the whole thing here as observer to get the right information. And this way you should be able to hit your target accurately. And the last part here, I'm gonna show you really quick how the M270 MLRS works. This is pretty self-explanatory, I guess, so you have figured it out by now. It has an artillery computer that does all the calculations for you. So very simple. And it's the same thing as in vanilla ArmA. So you can... It's nothing special in ACE. So if you go in the right in the back seat, you should get the... the gunner seat, you should get the option artillery computer. You click on that, and then this sort of map appears. What I can do here is not much actually. You see here grid distance, min max, direction and altitude. That is gonna change depending on where my mouse cursor is pointing at. So the target grid, the distance from me to the target. You see those two circles, inner and outer circle, and then you get mode, type, burst, ammo. That's about it. So what I'm gonna do here, or what I can adjust here, is semi-close, semi-medium, semi-far. I'm on semi-close now. If you go to semi-medium, you see those two circles are increasing. Semi-far is right here. So this is the inner circle, minimum range of fire, maximum range of fire. To designate the target, I just click on the map. And it will be indicated by this dot right here. You see the distance to target, and you see the ETA, the estimated time of arrival for the rocket to arrive on target, which is 86 seconds. I got a second target right here. I'm gonna mark it. Then here I click on fire. You see the rocket going. And what you see now here as a gunner is the ETA of the rounds. You see they're on the way. And with that information, you could, if you got radio comms with an observer, you can give him information about the splash. About the splash, you know. So I'm gonna go back and switch to the observer down here. So those rounds should come down right where those few vehicles are standing. As you can see, that is really nothing special. It's obviously the most effective artillery, it's the most accurate and the most powerful, but it's not really a challenge to use it. There we go, splash one. And splash two. That's already the whole shebang. Alright people, this is it with my artillery tutorial for ACE and ArmA 2. I hope it was understandable, and you guys are going to be able to use ACE artillery now yourself. It was a bitch to create, to be honest. It took me about maybe 10 hours, you know, from starting to trying to get to understand all this stuff. Huge credit here to ArmA Station's channel. Because I pretty much learned how to use it from their videos, and yeah, it's pretty cool. It's a lot of fun, and I hope you guys are going to be able to use it now as well. I did not cover the mortars or artillery, but range tables. Maybe I'm gonna give that a try as well and do a separate video. If not, just try to find other videos on YouTube. There is stuff out there if you give it a try and spend some time searching for it. Also, I do hope that you appreciate the extra efforts in editing, you know, with the chapter selection and all that. I did it once for the USS Nimitz add-on tutorial. Personally, I think it's pretty cool. It gives the video a bit more of a professional look. But also here, it just increases the amount of time you use to create a video quite a bit. So I guess there's nothing left for me to say except thanks a lot for watching. Please comment and rate the video, give it some thumbs up, show it some love and support so I know my work is appreciated. And subscribe to my channel if you haven't done it yet. A lot of other ArmA 2 and ACE tutorials on there and some other fun stuff as well. So thanks for checking in, and I'll catch you guys soon. Maverick out.